In the summer of 1942, the Japanese Empire stretched over a vast area of the Western Pacific. After the attack on Pearl Harbor in December 1941, Japanese forces moved quickly to capture Hong Kong, Burma, Malaya, Borneo, the Philippines, and Singapore. By the spring of 1942, Japanese troops were in New Guinea as the expanding empire swept into the Solomon Islands. By the end of May, Japanese territory spread as far as the large jungle island that would give its name to one of the best-known episodes of the Pacific War, Guadalcanal. Japan's expansion was a seemingly relentless advance, but around the time they reached Guadalcanal, the tide was already beginning to turn against the empire. The May 1942 Battle of the Coral Sea forced Japan to shelve the idea of attacking New Guinea's capital, Port Moresby. In early June, the stunning American victory at Midway persuaded the Japanese leadership to halt their expansion into the Pacific. Consolidation was now the order of the day. But the empire was still a force to be reckoned with. In the middle of June 1942, Allied intelligence in the Solomon Islands reported a worrying development. The Japanese occupiers of Guadalcanal were constructing an airfield on the north coast of the island. Coconut trees were being felled in their thousands, and the reports suggested that the air strip would be operational in a matter of weeks. This was serious news for the Allies. A Japanese air presence on Guadalcanal would threaten the precious supply line between Hawaii and Australia. In Washington, the American chiefs of staff considered their response. One idea was to carry out a raid against Guadalcanal and put the airfield out of commission. But eventually a plan was hatched that was far more bold in scope. Instead of merely raiding Guadalcanal, the Americans decided to capture the island. The plan was to effect an amphibious landing by American Marine forces, eject the small Japanese presence, and establish an Allied airbase on the island. By June the 25th, the decision was made to go ahead with the operation. Its code name, Watchtower. When the decision was made to capture Guadalcanal, the American planners knew very little about the background that lay ahead. The island was almost entirely unfamiliar. Maps were few and unreliable, and only a limited air reconnaissance was possible. And this was not the only problem that affected American preparations. The success of the Guadalcanal offensive would depend on the Marine troops, whose task was to go ashore and physically capture the vital airstrip. But when the Marine commander, General Vandegrift, received his orders at his headquarters in New Zealand on the 25th of June, he knew that his men were far from combat ready. It was only in the previous month that the Marines had left their home base in North Carolina, and by the end of June, only a third of their number had arrived in New Zealand. General Vandegrift had been told not to expect any operational duties until 1943. Now, his unprepared division was expected to go into battle in a matter of weeks. Vandegrift was forced into urgent preparations in New Zealand as his men and supplies arrived in the region. Despite an outbreak of influenza amongst his troops and the inconvenience of a strike amongst the dock workers in the Port of Wellington, by the end of July, the Marine troops were in position on the island of Fiji, awaiting a final rehearsal for the task ahead. General Vandegrift had by now secured a postponement of the day of attack from August the 1st to August the 7th. But he knew that his preparation time had been far from ideal, and in Fiji, the inexperience of the American Marines revealed itself. The Guadalcanal expedition would be an amphibious operation, quite unprecedented in size, and the Fiji exercise revealed the logistical difficulties involved. There was little evidence of coordination between the amphibious landing groups and the accompanying naval and air support. Equipment proved unreliable, and the whole exercise was judged to be little less than a farce, but there could be no delay in the timetable. August the 7th would be the date when the American plan would be put into action. The intentions of the American leadership for the Guadalcanal offensive were relatively straightforward. An armada of transport ships would sail from Fiji to the Solomon Islands and enter the channel to the north of Guadalcanal. There, the main amphibious force would take to their landing crafts and go ashore, while supporting units secured the smaller islands of Tulagi, Gavutu, and Tamonbogo. The transport vessels would not be alone. Instead, they were just part of a much larger invasion force. To the north and northeast lay a substantial protective naval presence under the command of Admiral Crutchley of the Royal Australian Navy. 5 cruisers and 9 destroyers. Generous air support was also provided. Some 100 miles to the south, an American carrier fleet formed into position. The value of the aircraft carrier had already been proved dramatically at the Coral Sea and at Midway, and so the carriers Saratoga, Wasp, and Enterprise were deployed to provide fighter support for the Guadalcanal offensive. Alongside the carriers, 1 battleship, 6 cruisers, and some 16 destroyers. These substantial resources were all deployed in support of Vandegrift's 1st Marine Division, a landing force reinforced with crack units of paratroops and marine raiders. But nothing could hide the fact that the 1st Marine Division had only been formed recently, and that the majority of its men lacked any experience of battle. The American Marines could not be sure of the size of the force that awaited them on Guadalcanal, but they could guess at the strength of the Japanese fighting spirit. The best intelligence available suggested that a force of 7,000 troops were in position on the island, and these were likely to include soldiers with recent experience of fighting in difficult jungle conditions. By contrast, there were few men in the American Marines who had ever come across an environment like that of Guadalcanal. The Americans also knew that Japanese strength did not derive only from its positions at Guadalcanal itself. Somewhere to the northwest, in the vicinity of New Britain, lurked the might of Japanese naval power, the 4th Inner South Sea Fleet. These were the concerns that faced the American commanders on the eve of battle in early August 1942. In overall command of the Watchtower operation was Vice Admiral Robert Lee Gormley. A 57-year-old who had served as a liaison officer in London, Gormley arrived in New Zealand in March 1942 to take up command of the South Pacific area and South Pacific Force. Not long afterwards, he received the order to proceed with the Guadalcanal attack. But Gormley would not be in the South Pacific when the fighting finally ended. His eventual removal may have been the result of one of his decisions in the early days of the offensive. But in August 1942, Admiral Gormley was the man in charge. Amongst his subordinates, Rear Admiral Frank J. Fletcher, known to his men as Black Jack. A veteran of the Battle of the Coral Sea and the Battle of Midway, Fletcher was seen as an ideal choice to command the naval task force on which the success of the Guadalcanal offensive would depend. But Fletcher's reputation would also be affected by the decision of his superior, Admiral Gormley. Once again, there was no such concern when operations began. Rear Admiral Fletcher's huge task force was divided into 2 groups, with the key amphibious force under the command of Rear Admiral Richmond J. Turner. Like Gormley and Fletcher, Turner was in his late 50s, although he had never seen active combat service. Instead, he was regarded as an authority in the business of planning an amphibious attack. At Guadalcanal, he would get the chance to put his theories into practice. Rear Admiral Turner's direct subordinates included Major General Alexander A. Vandegrift and it was this Marine commander who would become most associated with the eventual outcome at Guadalcanal. A veteran of the so-called Banana Wars in the Caribbean, Vandegrift knew all about jungle fighting. Though he was astonished when he learned how little time his 1st Marine Division would have to prepare for the offensive, this gifted soldier put aside his concerns as he took on the business of leadership on the ground. Vandegrift's Marine Division was reinforced with paratroops. It was also supported by the 1st Marine Raider Unit under the command of Colonel Merritt Edson. Like his commander, Edson had combat experience, and it was for this reason that his raiders were given one of the most difficult tasks on the opening day of battle. Known to his men as Red Mike, Edson was a master of special tactics, and he would become one of the most celebrated soldiers of the Pacific War, with Guadalcanal the first location to witness his abilities as a leader of men. The Americans enjoyed no monopoly of excellent leadership at Guadalcanal. In charge of Japanese naval operations in the South Pacific was Vice Admiral Gunichi Mikawa. Prior to the American attack, Mikawa had expressed well-documented concerns about the fractured nature of the Japanese Pacific Command. But when fighting began, Mikawa would put his opinions to one side as he deployed his naval forces in brilliant style. Complementing Mikawa's naval forces, the Japanese regional ground presence consisted of the 17th Army of Lieutenant General Harukichi Hayakutake. General Hayakutake had a formidable force at his disposal. The 50,000 men that made up 17th Army included the 35th Infantry Brigade of Major General Kawaguchi, a commander who revealed his keenness for the fight as soon as he was engaged on Guadalcanal. A strong desire to get to grips with the enemy was also revealed by Colonel Kiyono Ichiki, a veteran of the war in China, and a passionate believer in the prowess of the individual Japanese soldier. As commander of the 2nd Battalion, 28th Infantry Regiment, Colonel Ichiki had the chance to put his beliefs to the test in the first major land action on Guadalcanal itself. It would be an engagement where Colonel Ichiki revealed just how much motivation a commander can instill in his men. It would also be an action that would give rise to one of the most enduring myths about the Guadalcanal offensive. But there can be no doubt that Colonel Ichiki experienced at first hand the power of the weapons available to his enemy. The American triumph at the Battle of Midway proved once and for all the importance of powerful carrier aircraft. And of the dive bombers available to the American commanders, there was none better than the Douglas SBD, the Dauntless. All through the Pacific War, this two-seater warplane proved a menace to Japanese ships. With one 1,600-pound fuselage-mounted bomb and two 325-pound devices on the wings, this elegant aircraft was quick to prove its value against ground positions during the fighting at Guadalcanal. Colonel Ichiki's men would become especially aware of the Dauntless's power. American commanders were also able to deploy a great carrier-borne fighter in the Guadalcanal theater, the F-4F, the Wildcat, a single-seat fighter whose distinctive form was powered by a 1,200-horsepower engine generating a top speed of 318 miles per hour. By August 1942, the Wildcat had also seen action at Midway and at the Coral Sea. And though perhaps not as great a warplane as the Dauntless, the introduction of the Wildcat proved invaluable for the American efforts at Guadalcanal. The Bell P-400 was essentially an export version of the P-39 Era Cobra, and as such, lacked, amongst other components, the ability to fit oxygen bottles, giving it a maximum ceiling of 12,000 feet. Unusable as an interceptor, its formidable armament of one nose-mounted 37mm cannon, 2.50 caliber and 4.30 caliber machine guns, together with two 500-pound bombs, ideally suited the P-400 to the ground attack role. With its unusual tricycle undercarriage and the engine placed behind the pilot, the propeller drive shaft running between his legs, the P-400 was not popular with the men who flew it. Despite this valuable support from the air, Vandegrift and his colleagues knew that they would also need substantial amounts of ground resources for the kind of jungle warfare that lay ahead. The marine troops themselves were a key resource. To get them from the transport ships to the shore, the American forces relied on landing craft like the LCIL, the Landing Craft Infantry Large. In operation, this 160-foot vessel had the ability to deliver 210 troops to the beach via the ramp gangways fitted to either bow. The LCIL could also be used to deliver 75 tons of material, and at Guadalcanal, American hardware on the ground included light, mobile tanks, well suited to jungle warfare. The most famous of these was the M3. First produced in 1941, its six guns were dominated by a main weapon of 37mm caliber. With armor up to 43mm thick, the M3 provided strong protection for its four-man crew. Unfortunately, a problem with the disembarkation at the Guadalcanal beachhead meant that General Vandegrift could not call on as many of these fine vehicles as he had originally hoped. But the contribution of the M3 was still crucial in some of the fiercest engagements of the offensive. The conflict on Guadalcanal saw the use, for the first time in a combat situation, of the American-built Landing Vehicle Tract, or the Alligator, developed from the rescue craft used in the swamp areas of the southern USA in the mid-1930s. Powered by two Cadillac V8 engines, propulsion through the water came from paddles attached to the tracks, which would also help mobility on soft, sandy beaches. Over 18,000 vehicles were built, including various models with differing offensive armaments, ranging from the fitting of tank turrets to the upper surfaces, through to the addition of 75mm howitzers. But the main benefit of the Alligator was its ability to drive straight out of the water and into cover before unloading its cargo, making it far less a target than ships, men, and supplies lined up on an exposed beach. Another American weapon that proved itself, not only at Guadalcanal but also in subsequent jungle battles, was the 75mm pack howitzer, the M1A1. Light and maneuverable, the pack howitzer was a long-established weapon in the American arsenal. Ideal for dropping by parachute, the M1A1 possessed a maximum range of some 9,700 yards, and the Japanese would feel the force of its 13-pound shells in the fighting of 1942. A light and versatile weapon, the 37mm gun, when used in the anti-tank role, fired a solid shot round that could penetrate 25mm of armor at 1,000 yards, and an armor-piercing round that could penetrate 58mm. Both types of rounds proved more than adequate in defeating the lightly armored tanks used by the Japanese on Guadalcanal. It was when used in the anti-personnel role that the 37mm gun proved its worth with devastating effect. Using canister fire, the gun was effectively turned into a 37mm shotgun. While posing little threat against tanks, it could decimate the frontal infantry attacks favored by the Japanese. Weighing in at 912 pounds, the gun was very light and could easily be dismantled and transported through the jungle. Over 18,000 were produced, and the gun was widely used in the Pacific theater. The standard weapon of the infantrymen of the Second World War was the rifle. Most of the world's armies at this time used the hand-operated bolt-action weapon that had been in use since before the First World War. The only exception to this rule was the US military. Entering service in 1936 and standard issue by 1940, the M1 Garand rifle was a gas-operated, semi-automatic rifle fed by an 8-round magazine. Slightly heavier than the traditional rifle, the M1 Garand was a particularly reliable weapon, a significant advantage when fighting in the damp jungle conditions of Guadalcanal. But for all the quality of the American hardware, the circumstances of the Guadalcanal assault meant that not enough material was actually landed on the island. The fact that American ground commanders were not able to call on their full complement of hardware continues to be discussed today. What is certain is that when the American transport ships withdrew, half their material cargo was still on board, and the Marines left behind knew that their enemy also possessed many fine weapons of war. Success in jungle warfare can often be decided by one of the most ancient of all aspects of combat, the skill and resources of the individual soldier. And for the Japanese infantryman, much of his strength derived from the quality of his rifle, typically the Type 99. Originally introduced as the Type 38 in the early years of the 20th century, the 1930s saw this 9-pound weapon modified from its original 6.5mm caliber to accommodate a new 7.7mm cartridge. Extensively used in the fighting in China, the Type 99 was an ideal gun for the jungle sniper, and Japanese troops were also keen to use the weapon with its bayonet attached, as the American Marines found out in one of the bloodiest engagements of the Guadalcanal fighting. The Japanese infantryman could also draw confidence from the weapons used to support him. The Type 92 battalion gun may have been one of the strangest looking machines of the Second World War, but it was also one of the most widely used. Its relatively short range meant that it was often used for direct fire duties in close contact with the enemy, a task greatly assisted by its relative lightness in action. This enabled the Japanese gunners to attack, move on, and then attack again from an entirely new direction of fire. A tactic that made a disturbing impact upon the troops who found themselves in the Type 92's sights. The Japanese, like the Americans, also recognized the value of carrier-launched warplanes. And in 1942, they possessed a seaborne carrier aircraft at the peak of its powers, the legendary Mitsubishi A6M, the Zero Fighter, or as American troops christened it, the Zeke. A single-seat aircraft, the Zero was introduced in 1939, and its capabilities came to the attention of the Allies when it was used during the attack on Pearl Harbor. Its range was remarkable, its speed equally impressive, and its pilots enjoyed excellent maneuverability. The Zero's armament was also a force to be reckoned with. Two machine guns in the nose, with two 20mm cannons mounted in the wings. Developed to replace the GM3, which had been in production since 1936, the Mitsubishi G4M entered service in the spring of 1941. The G4M, or Betty Bomber, as it was known by the Americans, was the Japanese Navy's frontline land-based bomber. The Betty was armed with one cannon and four machine guns, and was also capable of carrying either a full bomb load or a single torpedo, a weapon ideally suited to the Pacific conflict. In the early stages of the war in the Pacific, the Betty proved to be a worthy opponent against the limited performance of the US fighters. But as better Allied aircraft began to enter the Pacific theater, the situation began to change. Like the Mitsubishi Zero, the Betty was designed without self-sealing tanks to increase performance and range, and subsequently became notorious with the airmen who flew it as a fire hazard. Derived from the Type 89 medium tank, which first came into service in 1929 and saw extensive service in the war with China, the Chi-Ha Type 97 was hopelessly outclassed when engaging even the smallest American tanks. The earlier Type 89's main gun could not be loaded with armor-piercing rounds, which relegated it to an infantry support vehicle. The Type 97's better armament of a 47mm gun and two machine guns could do nothing to improve its combat effectiveness. With armor plating no thicker than 30mm, under half that of its American counterpart, the Sherman. The Type 97 was used widely by the Japanese Army throughout the entire Pacific conflict. The 70mm infantry howitzer, or mountain gun Type 92, was found to be completely inadequate against American armor and was relegated to nothing more than an infantry support weapon. The one major advantage of this artillery piece during the conflict was that it was capable of being dismantled and carried by its crew of five, albeit with some difficulty, through the dense jungle and hilly terrain of Guadalcanal. A light gun, weighing 468 pounds, roughly half the weight of the comparable American gun, it fired an 8.3-pound high-explosive round up to a range of 3,000 yards. While the Japanese military failed to recognize the submachine gun as a viable infantry weapon, it regularly employed the light machine gun in an infantry support role. The Nambu 7.7mm Type 99 light machine gun was actually based on the British Bren gun and used extensively in the Guadalcanal campaign. The Nambu was an extremely accurate weapon with a high rate of fire and could even be fitted both with a bayonet and a telescopic sight. To the Japanese officer, the samurai sword was a revered symbol of the spirit of ancient Japan, believed to be the embodiment of the samurai's code, the expression of his iron discipline, and unswerving devotion to duty. The swords issued to Japanese officers were generally lower quality, mass-made examples. But as fighting weapons, and as a symbol of military authority, a sword was considered essential by Japanese officers. Even by World War II, with the development of far more effective and destructive weapons, the sword, carried into battle by a Japanese officer, held a vital link with the ancient samurai code of honor, Bushido. As the American invasion force moved into position in the Solomon Islands on the 7th of August 1942, the story of the Pacific War still had a long way to run, but the next chapter was about to begin at Guadalcanal. To the pleasant surprise of the American troops, the landing on Guadalcanal was made without the attentions of the enemy. This was fortunate, since the disembarkation proved to be as uncoordinated as the rehearsal suggested it might be. Before long, the so-called Red Beach was strewn with supplies, men, and material, and no one seemed to know who was responsible for what. But at least the Japanese were nowhere to be seen, and by the end of the day, the Marines were already moving towards the Japanese airfield. But elsewhere, the forces of the Empire were present in numbers. At Tulagi, the Marine raiders of Colonel Edson encountered fierce Japanese resistance, especially during the night that followed the landing. In the darkness of the jungle, no fewer than four Japanese assaults were beaten back, and it took until the end of the second day before Colonel Edson could report the final reduction of Japanese troops. Fierce battles were also joined at the connected islets of Gavutu and Tamonbogo, with the latter only falling after the intervention of naval support, the big guns of the destroyer Buchanan. The Americans had always expected the task of capturing the small islands to be difficult, but on Guadalcanal itself, success proved to be relatively straightforward, at least at first. By the afternoon of the second day of operations, American Marines had moved west from Red Beach to secure possession of the nearly completed Japanese airfield, a site quickly given the name Henderson Field in honor of a hero of the Battle of Midway. The Japanese forces had simply fled to the hills. As dusk fell on the 8th of August 1942, the first objective of the operation had been achieved. And although losses on the Northern Islands had been heavy, General Vandegrift could reflect on a job well done. But any overconfidence would prove to be premature. As soon as the Americans made their move, Admiral Mikawa of the Japanese 4th Inner South Sea Fleet ordered a battle group to set sail for Guadalcanal, through the Solomon Islands channel that became known as the Slot. But before they could arrive, Mikawa also dispatched a force of bombers with fighter escort against the American forces. Alerted, Admiral Fletcher dispatched 60 Wildcat fighters to greet them in the skies over Guadalcanal. In a fierce dogfight, 16 Japanese aircraft were lost against a total of 11 American planes. Admiral Turner decided to move his own fleet into defensive positions north and south of Savo Island, with the destroyers Blue and Ralph Talbot in the advanced positions. It was these outposts that were first sighted by the Japanese battle groups at 0100 hours on the morning of the 9th of August. Minutes later, Admiral Mikawa's cruiser fleet sailed past, entirely unnoticed. Now he ordered his small, cruiser-borne float planes into the air. At 0145 hours, their pilots began to drop flares that revealed the full presence of the Allied ships. Now Mikawa gave the order for the torpedoes to be launched and the big guns to be fired. The Battle of Savo Island had begun. The Japanese had taken their enemy by surprise, and they made their advantage pay. The Allied cruisers Vincennes, Quincy, Canberra, and Astoria were all lost. Another was seriously damaged as the Japanese battle group swept round Savo Island and back out through the slot to the northwest. The Imperial Navy had triumphed in the first of four major battles that would take place in the seas around Guadalcanal. For the Marine commander Vandegrift, this loss of supporting firepower was a disaster, and the Battle of Savo Island was a comprehensive victory for the Japanese. But the Americans could console themselves with the fact that Mikawa's fleet had not taken out the transport ships. But more bad news had already reached the Marines. In the hours before the Japanese attack, General Vandegrift was informed of a decision made by Admiral Fletcher. He had decided to withdraw his force of carriers in the south, having agreed with his superior, Admiral Gormley, that fuel and aircraft resources were insufficient to maintain a secure presence in the region. As a consequence of this controversial decision, Admiral Turner announced that he would also have to withdraw his amphibious task force. By the end of the 9th of August, just 2 days into the operation, Admiral Turner's ships had left Guadalcanal, taking half of the Marines' supplies and material with him. There had been no time to unload any more. On Guadalcanal, and on the smaller islands to the north, the 1st Marine Division were left to fend for themselves. It was potentially a disastrous turn of events. There was nothing else for Vandegrift to do but secure his defensive perimeter as best he could, and set his men to the task of completing the Henderson Field airstrip. If it could be brought into operation quickly, it would be a precious asset to the now isolated Marines. The work was hampered by the lack of materials and also by the constant presence of Japanese warplanes in the skies above. Before long, the enemy would be even closer at hand. In the hot, humid jungle conditions, General Vandegrift's inexperienced men were quickly learning the often desperate facts of war. The Japanese 17th Army of Lieutenant General Hayakutake was now ordered to retake Guadalcanal, and he selected the 35th Infantry Brigade of Major General Kawaguchi to carry out the task. It was now that Rear Admiral Tanaka came up with the imaginative idea of moving troops from New Britain to Guadalcanal using fast night convoys of cruisers and destroyers, the so-called rat runs, which became known as the Tokyo Express. Such was the effectiveness of the procedure in delivering Japanese forces to Guadalcanal. On the 18th of August, with the Henderson Field still not operational, the first of these night convoys succeeded in landing two echelons of troops. To the west, a special landing force went ashore at Kokumbona. To the east, at Taivu Point, the 2nd Battalion of the 28th Infantry Regiment, under the command of Colonel Ichiki. It was a bold move, perhaps a little too bold. General Hayakutake decided not to wait for his scattered 35th Infantry Brigade to form up. Instead, he acted at once, and Ichiki's men quickly advanced from their beachhead. By the evening of the 20th of August, they had reached the edge of the American position to the east of Alligator Creek. That night, Colonel Ichiki launched his attack. It was a fearsome engagement that became known as the Battle of the Temaru. The Japanese hurled themselves at the Americans in a bayonet charge. Their courage was phenomenal as they ran into the line of American artillery, machine gun, and infantry fire. When they were forced to withdraw, the inspirational Ichiki ordered the survivors to regroup, and once again they charged the American positions. But the bravery of Ichiki's men would not be enough. By the following afternoon, the Japanese assault had failed, and the last of Ichiki's men found themselves surrounded by an American force now reinforced by light armor. At some point, Colonel Ichiki himself died in the fighting, although a popular myth suggests that he committed harakiri when he realized that the battle was lost. The American victory at the Temaru was total, and the battlefield was a scene of slaughter. 800 of Ichiki's 900 men were dead. Significantly, the final elimination of the Japanese troops was assisted by American power in the air. The Henderson Field was now operational, and on August the 20th, 19 Wildcat fighters and 12 Dauntless dive bombers landed on Guadalcanal. The American occupation was now a less tentative enterprise. But the battle for the island was still far from won. In late August and early September, the ships of the Tokyo Express brought substantial numbers of troops to the east and west of Vandegrift's perimeter. In early September, the American commander brought his raiders and paratroops onto Guadalcanal itself, and on September the 7th, dispatched them east to Tasimbako, a village believed to be a center of Japanese strength. Vandegrift's intelligence was accurate. Japanese troops were based in Tasimbako, and a brief engagement resulted before the raiders captured the village. But the Japanese contingent was small, and Colonel Edson soon found out why. A far larger force had been present in Tasimbako, but they had now moved on. This was the 35th Brigade of General Kawaguchi, and it had set off south into the jungle with the likely intention of moving west before attacking Henderson Field to the north. Hurriedly, General Vandegrift organized his men into position for the suspected Japanese attack. His assumption was that his Japanese counterpart would strike against the ridge that lay to the south of the airstrip. If they did, they would find the American raiders and paratroops waiting for them. Vandegrift's assumption was correct. On the evening of the 12th of September, Japanese warships unleashed a barrage of shellfire, not against the airfield, but against the ridge that would provide the grim name for the battle to come, Bloody Ridge. It would be no exaggeration. When the Japanese shelling ceased, Kawaguchi's men made an initial assault that pushed the American defenders back. But the real attack came the following evening, September the 13th. That night saw the island of Guadalcanal enveloped in the fog of war. Kawaguchi's brigade now launched themselves forward in a heroic drive against the American positions. They were met by a line of mortar and artillery fire. But heavy Japanese firepower was also deployed from a group of seven destroyers in the coastal waters to the north. The American Wildcat pilots were also able to bring the power of their guns to bear. But still the Japanese infantry surged forward. It was a night of desperate fighting. On no fewer than 12 occasions, the Japanese troops charged the American line. On occasions, the defense appeared on the point of breaking, but the raiders and paratroops somehow held firm throughout the night. By the morning of the 14th of September, the battle was won. And what was left of Kawaguchi's force was retreating east. The ridge was covered with bodies, and it was still in American hands. Henderson Field remained secure. General Vandegrift had arrived on Guadalcanal on August the 7th with a largely inexperienced body of men. Now, 6 weeks later, they had become a battle-hardened force to be reckoned with. But there was no time for complacency. The Marines still faced many difficulties on Guadalcanal. Tropical diseases such as dysentery were rife amongst the American troops. A typical roll call revealed 1 in 5 men on the sick list. There was also the continued presence of the enemy. Vandegrift's men were allowed no respite from Japanese bombardment from the air and from the sea. By mid-October, the Japanese ground presence on Guadalcanal had also been reinforced. The commander of 17th Army had moved his headquarters to the island, and General Hayakutake could call on a force of 20,000 men for a new assault against an American presence, itself now 23,000 strong. This would be the third major Japanese attack. It would also be the last. In broad terms, General Hayakutake's plan was for a simultaneous attack from two sides. From the west, Major General Sumiyoshi would lead an assault, with armored support, against the American perimeter. At his disposal, some 5,600 men. Meanwhile, to the south, Major General Kawaguchi would attack with 7,000 men and a strong artillery element. On the evening of the 22nd of October, the Battle of Henderson Field began. To the west, an artillery barrage announced Japanese intentions. When the guns fell silent, Sumiyoshi's battalions threw themselves against the American defensive line with the support of their tanks. Now it was the turn of the American big guns to intervene. Artillery pieces and dedicated anti-tank weapons rained down their shells on the Japanese men and armor. Infantry fire was also ferocious. And despite the trademark hunger for the fight displayed by the Japanese soldier, the Western assault was completely repulsed in a matter of hours. The American positions should also have been under simultaneous attack from the south, but here there was silence. General Maruyama had found the march through the Guadalcanal jungle tough going. Too tough. At the stated moment for the assault to begin, his men were still hacking their way through the thick vegetation. Crucially, Maruyama had to abandon his mortars and artillery pieces on the way. He was also out of communication with his colleagues to the west, and was thus unable to tell Sumiyoshi to delay. It was October the 24th, before the now weakened southern sector could make its attack, and the result was predictable. More fierce fighting and victory for the American Marines, leaving behind another blood-soaked battlefield. American satisfaction was now understandable. The Marines had seen off 3 major Japanese attempts to eject them from Guadalcanal. But celebration was tempered by the loss of the American carrier Hornet, during a naval engagement to the north of Guadalcanal. This was the Battle of Santa Cruz, the last of the four great sea battles that took place while the Marines struggled to maintain their hold on land. In general, Japanese sea power around Guadalcanal proved far more effective than their operations on the island itself. Both the Japanese and the American navies lost about 25 warships in the course of their confrontations in the region. But it is as a marine operation that Guadalcanal is best remembered today. When Vandegrift's exhausted men were finally withdrawn in early December, they had endured 4 months in isolated, difficult terrain with no respite from the attentions of the enemy. 1,600 Marines had died, 4,700 had been wounded. But they had won, and the Japanese knew it. Their casualty list was 4 times the size. On December 31st, the Imperial Command made the decision to withdraw the remaining Japanese forces from Guadalcanal. By February the 8th, they had gone, and the American 14th Corps were left in complete control of the island. In the months that followed, the Henderson Field airstrip was built up into a major military facility. The supply lines to Australia and New Zealand were secure, and the Japanese advance had been turned back for the first time. Now the Americans could consider the future with greater confidence, and Guadalcanal would be the first staging post on the long road that lay ahead. This previously unknown patch of jungle is now deservedly famous as the first of the many islands on which Americans were forced to hop on their way to final victory.